It has been very nice to be here. So I'm going to share some of our experience today about our work in primary immune deficiency. And I have a disclaimer. Usually they say I consult for a company or whatever. But my disclaimer is I'm not a geneticist, and genomics is above my ability and certainly above my pay grade. Actually, also, my mother will be very happy with this because she wanted me to be a rich doctor and to marry a rich girl. Unfortunately, neither of that happened. I married a penniless girl, and I do research. So the issue is summarized on this slide. Of the 30 or so thousand genes that you have, 10,000 are expressed in immune cells. And so far as of last month, we know genetic monogenic causes for 350 genes in primary immune deficiency. So if you make your math, you have about more than 9,000 genes, so it will keep a few generations busy. And some of the genes are only in immune cells, and some are, as we have published, many other genes are in non-immune cells as well as in immune cells as well. So this is my very simplistic understanding of genetics. Everything goes above my head. I am trained in cellular immunology. I may go down to the mRNA level, but got it into the nucleus and the DNA is a little hard for me. But we are dealing, concentrating on the human exome. So we are dealing with about 20,000 variants per individual. My student here, Sibel, corrected me yesterday to 30,000, but when you are stupid and ignorant, you believe anything. So we have to narrow this 20,000 variants that you get when you do your exome to about one or two disease variants, because as I will show you, and as many speakers yesterday showed, there are, because of intermarriage and consanguinity, there are sometimes more than one gene causing the disease. Of these 20,000 variants, 9,000 are non-synonymous variants. And as we'll show you, they cannot be ignored because you can have a very drastic effect on the immune system in our case. And 1,000 are rare variant and 200 are homozygous, more so if you have consanguinity. Some of our patients have 14% regions of their genome as a region of homozygosity. So we need to get back to that one or two. And actually, this whole thing started about 8 years ago. And we had both a strength and a weakness at that time. The weakness was that I work in Boston. And whereas in Europe, there are all these guest workers from Algeria, Morocco, Turkey, who are bring their first cousin and marry the families intermarry. So it was easier for the European immunologists to get gene discovery. For us, it was very difficult because, particularly if we follow Mr. Trump, we will only get Norwegians. So we don't have this population. And like the saying in the Arab world goes, if Muhammad doesn't go to the mountain, then the mountain will go to Muhammad. And that's exactly what we did about 7-8 years ago with some seed funding from the Harvard Dubai Foundation. At that time, Harvard, our dean at Harvard, who was a very famous economist, lost about half the fortune of Harvard. So they gave us half the money that said they would give. But at least we, he still got a full salary, mind you. And so at that time, we started a very small effort. And I looked up people on the internet. I really didn't know what to do because they had to have a presentation in Boston. So we got Basir Ramadi from Yale University, who I'd never met before, but he came. And since we have become very good friends. And we started the network. And these are the elements for doing this international network, which I will tell you about. So the elements really is to have very close collaboration. And the secret for that, you get an email and you answer it within 24 hours. And because we soon realized that physicians in all over the MENA region, and now we have spread to South America, they are much better knowledgeable about clinical problems than we are, because they see much more cases and much more severe cases. Email made a big difference. Somebody sends you an email, you can answer it. They send the whole case story. The rapid couriers were absolutely essential. We can get blood from anywhere within 48 hours. But we also learned a few lessons. Don't ship from Oman or Saudi Arabia in August because it's going to cook. And genomics and bioinformatics, we had to learn that. Luckily, at that time, one of my junior staff got married to a bioinformatician, and I took her aside and I said, look, tell him no dinner and no other things until he helps us do the bioinformatics. And of course, one strength we have is the strength of the biology, because those are unique cases, one gene, an immune system. If you think genetics is complicated, wait until you see the immune system. It's very complicated. So in the end, you become an expert at everything and an expert at nothing. So you have to find out with every gene what it does, and it's a different biologic system. So we made this network, and this network grew quite a bit over the last 6-7 years, so that now we have 34 collaborating centers, almost everywhere between about 10 time zones, and spreading all the way to Pakistan and India, and more recently to South America, where most of the cases, of course, are either X-linked or dominant negative, and everybody else in that region, including Greece and Italy, are primarily autosomal recessive. So this is our workflow. I'm sure you are familiar with it. So we recruit the individuals with PID phenotype. They send us the phenotypes, infections, maybe abnormalities, immunoglobulins, T cells, all kind of infection that give you an idea whether this is a B cell, T cell, whatever. And then we are using a panel, that second generation panel that we have developed with Thermo Fisher, which is soon going to be on the market, that has 335 plus PID genes. And of that panel, 64% of the time we get a known gene. Although some of those known genes are very interesting, because at least we have two that are known to be a gain of loss of function, dominant negative mutation, and we have now two genes of the same genes that are gain of function mutation. So even known genes, you still have surprises there. And the rest we go through whole exome sequencing. The upper part of the slide is very easy. It's 1 week and 2 months. We send our whole exome sequencing. We do the use ion torrent at home in our lab. And the rest is the most difficult thing, of course, is the mechanistic studies. And right now, when we find a new gene, if we suspect it's really the gene, we don't wait. We go directly CRISPR-Cas, which we can make in our lab, and we use the Harvard Genomic Facility for injecting the mice. And I'm going to update you. I think we have at least 12 or 15 mice with genetic defects that mimic human, including point mutation. So the idea is to, the ideal candidate is to have, if there is a distinct and novel phenotype, which you have never seen before, and also when you have a big family with multiple affected siblings and non-affected individuals, multiple of them in the same family, because you can do a lot of in silico filtering. And in some of those families with 8 children, 2 affected, 6 non-affected, basically we can eliminate a lot of areas that are homozygous and a lot of gene variants because of the non-affected children who may not be homozygous for the culprit but are homozygous for the non-culprits. And of the various permutations we have found, the best predictor is if you have a personal or family history of a life-threatening infection, then we have a very high odd ratio for finding the gene. And so far, we have published 5 genes, 7 I almost completely worked out, so those are definite, 8 are good candidates, and we are starting to analyze more than 50 whole exomes. I'm going to illustrate the lessons we have learned. I'm sure you are all familiar with it, but for somebody naive like me in genetics, those are eye-openers. And the first one is a pathogenic synonymous mutation, which was not reported by the commercial lab. This is a patient who came from King Faisal Hospital in Saudi Arabia, from Hassan al-Dakri. And that patient has lost a sister. She is a female. She has lost a sister with severe combined immunodeficiency, which for those of you who are not immunologists, means it is a very severe form of immune deficiency, starts very early in life, kills you usually in the first year, but not always. You have problems with T cells, so you get viruses and fungus, and you get problem with B cells, so you get bacteria. That's where the word C is combined, severe immune deficiency. So this patient clearly had a severe combined immune deficiency. Later, when the parents visited my office in the lab to get some blood, I noticed that the older kid who is 7 and 8 years had this violaceous rash. Turned out to have the same lesion, but he was less severely affected than the sister who came for transplant. Well, the problem is that the issue there is that this girl and her brother, later we knew that, had low T cell number and low natural killer cell number. I think you are all familiar with T cells. They have an antigen receptor specific for each antigen. Natural killer cells are innate cells. They recognize almost pattern receptors. They recognize some viral products and other products on cells that are virally infected. So adaptive versus immune cell. Now, it turns out we know from a lot of work that this form of T cell of immune deficiency, where the B cells are okay, but the T cells are low and the natural killer are low, are caused usually by a problem either in the gamma chain or JAK3. So these are two receptors, one on T cells, one on the NK cells. And the one on T cells is, and the one on NK cell is important for the development because they sense the signal from cytokines. The first cytokine is called IL-7. It drives T cell maturation. The IL-7 receptor chain is specific to IL-7. And then the signal transducing module is a common gamma chain that uses by multiple cytokine receptors. And then the downstream is a kinase called JAK3, and the signal flows. And if you have a mutation in either one of those three, you get no T cells. For NK cells, you need a cytokine called IL-15, so you use the IL-15 receptor and the same signaling module. So if you know that information and you know your biology well, and you can distinguish a boy from a girl, which sometimes, you know, with long hair and all that, I used to have long hair, it's hard to distinguish sometimes. This girl has autosomal recessive because she's a girl. So that rules out the gamma chain, which is on the X chromosome. And that leaves really JAK3 and IL-7 receptor, and IL-17 receptor. However, since the IL-7 receptor is only T cells, but she has both T cell and NK cell, so it cannot be IL-7 receptor or IL-15 receptor. It must be JAK3. So just by the strength of reasoning and the logic of reasoning, we knew that this girl must have either JAK3 or something maybe downstream of JAK3. When she came to us, she already had been sequenced through a commercial lab with a panel, and she was for all SCID genes, including the IL-7 receptor, the gamma chain, and JAK3, and was reported to be normal. Well, there is a lesson there. If it's a mouse, if it is a rodent, if it has fur, if it weighs 20 grams, if it looks like a mouse, then it's a mouse. So this girl looked like a JAK3 deficiency. So we decided to ignore the result, but ask for the data. While asking for the data, we did something very simple. We did a Western blot for JAK3. And this girl had no JAK3, because JAK3 is also expressed in B cells, and all her circulating lymphocytes were B cells, so we had a source. So we looked at the JAK3 expression, and she had very little protein. A little, but very little protein. And when we did maybe 10%, the brother, the same happened. And then we did also a functional assay to show that cytokines that depend on JAK3 for signaling, one of them is IL-2, the other is IL-7, IL-15, IL-4, these are two of them, IL-2 and IL-15, cannot transmit the signal because that module causes the phosphorylation of a transcription factor followed by a nuclear translocation, and that's called STAT5, and we measured phosphostat5. So this girl, when we looked again, when we got the data from the company, turned out to have, how do you go back? Oh, missing a slide, that's okay. Well, there is some kind of a, don't worry about it. She has a splice mutation. It's an important slide, but I missed it. It is a point mutation in exon 19, which does not cause a coding change, but it creates a new splice site, a non-canonical splice site, and 95% of the time she splices wrong and is out of frame, and that's why she is only about 5% of the protein level. So one cannot, so moral of the story, you cannot ignore a, and then we bone marrow transplanted her and cured her. Moral of the story, ask for the raw data if it is looking like a mouse, but it's not telling you it's a mouse, and perform functional studies. So the second example is a diegetic disease that is a family from King Faisal Medical Center from Mufarrah al-Zahrani. And the patient has something very unusual. The patient had mycobacteria, and there is a whole host of immune deficiency that gives you susceptibility to mycobacteria that my colleague Jean-Laurent Casanova has described, IL-12 receptor, IL-12, interferon gamma, receptor interferon itself. Recently, we have discovered that together. And so we expected to have something in that pathway of the interferon gamma pathway, or the immune interferon, or the type 2 interferon made by T cells. But she also had a huge amount of CMV. That you don't need interferon gamma for. That you need type 1 interferon. You need interferon alpha and interferon beta, mostly interferon alpha. They both use the same receptor. So immediately something clicked in our mind that this may be something unusual. And when we did, and these are the receptors, so this is the type 2 interferon, the interferon gamma receptor, important for mycobacteria. It has two chains. Mutations have been described in both the cytokine binding chain, R1, and the signal transducing chain, R2. And interferon alpha receptor is for type 1 interferon, and has two chains. One binds to the cytokine, and this has been described before recently as mutated. But the other chain has no mutation described. It's the R1 receptor, which also signal transduce. So when we did the exome sequencing, there were two candidate genes, and you guess what they are. One of them was interferon gamma, receptor 2, which has a frame shift. It misses a piece of the protein. This complex interferon gamma signals by phosphorylating STAT1. It is not, the protein is not expressed by FACS or very poorly expressed. There is no STAT1 phosphorylation on the Western blot down there. And also, if you dump interferon on a cell that does not express MHC class 2, then it will express MHC class 2. And the control responds very well by expressing class 2 and fibroblast after cathartic interferon treatment, but not the patient. So that story is closed and is not interesting because that's what you expect. The other story is that this is a new gene never seen mutated before and destroys the stop codon, so you have an extra piece to the gene. And it is homozygous. Parents are hets. And this signal also via STAT1 protein is expressed. It signals via STAT1 phosphorylation and STAT2 phosphorylation, and this is diminished. And most importantly, when we looked at either interferon alpha-driven antiviral genes on the top part of the slide, and we looked at three of them, or we looked at actually virus infection of fibroblasts from the patient and looked for protective antiviral genes, both of them were reduced significantly in the patient. So, and finally, we used actual CMV virus and showed that if you lentivirally reintroduce the protein that is mutated, then, this is the control. If you put the interferon, then you reduce, these are two viral proteins that are expressed when you put the virus, you put interferon, and they are disappearing. In the patient, they still stay quite a bit, but then if you reconstitute the patient with the wild type, they virtually disappear. So that's, we fulfilled the Cox principle of showing that this is a causative gene without having to make a mouse with the point mutation in this case, because the in vitro systems are tractable to look at this question and establish causality. So so this is, in summary, what happened. This mutation here with the loss of the tail explains the mycobacteria and the other mutation, which gives an extra piece, and a novel gene. explains the CMV. And moral of the story, dual homozygous PID gene mutation are likely to be common in inbred populations. In our series of 600 patients, it's 2%. We have two genes. We have one patient with three genes that cause three separate immune deficiencies. And finally, never take for granted if it doesn't fit the clinical picture. Before one says that this is, oh, this is background gene, one should probably do a WES if it's a very unusual manifestation and see if you have a second gene. I will finish in 3 minutes, so please relax. Please take a deep breath. So the mystery defect. So this is an unusual case. It comes from here, from the United Arab Emirates. And this is a patient who was sent to us by Dr. Hibal Shendi from Al Ain Hospital, Tawan. And this is a lovely boy. He's charmed everybody in the children's hospital. And he had mycobacteria in the brain. And he had also hypogammaglobulinemia. I told you about patients who have problem with mycobacterial infection. Those, as you expect anybody, like patients with cystic fibrosis, their gamma globulin level is high because they have a huge antigenic load. They are bombarded by antigen. They can't eliminate the bacteria. So this is already saying, I am unusual. I have mycobacteria in the brain and I am hypogammaglobulin. The patient was seen before in Germany with my good friend Klaus Schwartz, who called me and I called him when the patient came to Boston and said, look, you have seen this patient. He said, yeah, I did the whole exome sequencing. He sent me the thing, nothing fit. He thought it was Jack 1, but it wasn't. So at that time we had a collaboration. Merck, who have the building next door, offered to do for us to do 100 whole exome for free through the Broad Institute. So we send it, well, it's free. Like they say in Arabic, شو أطيب من العسل خل بلاش. So we sent it there. What's sweeter than honey? Vinegar for free. For those who cannot speak an old language like ours. So we sent it there and, you know, we trusted the Broad, you know, the Broad is the Broad. And they said no mutations that is significant. However, in this desperation, I said, let's do something we used to do in the past. Let's immunize this child. Give him a booster antigen and do a biopsy of the lymph node about 10 days later and see whether he makes plasma cells. And the surgeon calls from the operating room. He said, I cannot find any lymph node. I said, oh my God, we had already worked on the non-canonical NF-kappa B pathway. This is a pathway that is absolutely the only pathway that you need to make lymph nodes and to make Peyer's patches in your gut. If this pathway is interrupted, you cannot make lymph node. You have normal number of T and B cells, but they can't talk to each other because the lymph node is like the cave downstairs, the bar where people meet. This is when they get for a date. They talk to each other. They organize things that we are not gonna talk about. So if you don't have a lymph node, nothing is gonna happen. People are just going like two ships at night. They're not going to talk to each other. You don't get a specific immune response. And that pathway is very important because it starts with a ligand called LT-beta, which binds to on stromal cells. These are cells in your body that are non-immune cells that help organize lymph nodes because when you activate them with LT-beta, they make chemokines that attract the lymphocyte and they make adhesion molecules that will make the lymphocyte stop there. And that's how you make a lymph node. And that pathway starts with an enzyme called NIC, which degraded all the time until the cell is exposed to LT-beta. And then you activate a kinase, IKK-alpha, which then takes one of the member of the NF-kappa-beta family called P100, phosphorylated, it gets processed to an active form, P52, binding to its partner, it moves in the nucleus, and you get all these chemokines and things. And you can see here that if you do this trick, you see the P52 being generated here in the wild, in the control, and very little P52 is generated here. So there is something wrong with this pathway. And we had this patient with a lot of region of homozygosity, had 2,200 genes there, and NIC was in this region. And then we did the test here, and we showed that then we started thinking, what is there in this pathway? And the only thing that was expressed poorly was this NIC here. This was September 2017. I presented this case as an unknown case in the European Society of Immune Deficiency. And this was a puzzle because then we thought maybe there is a regulatory element that is of NIC so that you have very little expression. It couldn't be with this experiment. It could not be a chaperone that is without it, the NIC is being disappearing, chewed up. So it may be a regulatory element. But before we started bashing the introns and the exons, you know the game, the famous Indian movie, we have this game in America where people go silly on the TV and they have to answer question, and if you don't know, they call a friend. Well, I called a friend. And this friend happened to be sitting here on the first row. And his name is, what's your name? His name is Fauzan. So I called Fauzan and I said, we have a problem. I mean, I don't know what to do before we start bashing. Can you please look at this? He said, well, send me some DNA. By that time, we have found, finally, we obtained, after much negotiation, blood from two cousins didn't have mycobacteria, but they were hypogamma globulinemic. And so Fauzan took the data. This was September. And here is Fauzan. You remember your email? It's edited a little. All the bad words are out. I don't want to embarrass you. So he sent me this and my junior investigator, and he says, I have some really exciting news for you. We were able to identify in the patient and the two cousins a single candidate autologous interval, and there is a gene called MPK4, and he has a frame shift. And me, the stupid immunologist, knowing nothing into genetics, I go quickly. It was breakfast time, if you don't notice the time there, 4 a.m. plus 7:11. I leave late. I work late. So I go down and tell my wife, we have a new gene, MPK4. And I said, let me go on Google. Let me see what is MPK4. And what MPK4 is the gene code for NIC. So our studies were showing that you have a problem with NIC expression. And then this is from Janet. She sent it back to me. And she said, what's happening? The Broad and BCH, we used two pipelines, used the ensemble reference transcript for MPK4. From the older reference genome build HD19, don't ask me what that is. I don't know. And it's like a parrot. I'm just repeating. And Fauzan redid the exome in his own lab and mapped the exome to more recent reference build, GRCH38, correct? Whatever that is, I don't know. But he found it. And notice, huh, he's not very modest. Don't be fooled by him. Look what he says. Best, I told you we would solve this mysterious family, and I'm glad we kept our word. Now, Fauzan, be careful what you write to people. There is a record now of everything. So with this, I want to say, be guided by the functional studies. Do not believe the result if it does not fit. Ask a friend for help. And I want to thank the people in the lab, particularly Janet. She is, what happened? You cut me off.